أعوذ بالله السميع العليم من الشيطان اللعين الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين الحمد لله والحمد حقه كما يستحقه حمدا كثيرا وأعوذ به من شر نفسي إن النفس لأمارة بالسوء إلا ما رحم ربي والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين خاتم النبيين سيدنا وحبيب قلوبنا وشفيع ذنوبنا أبي القاسم محمد
اللهم صل محمد وعلى محمد
وعلى أهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين المطهرين المكرمين ولعنة الله على أعدائهم أجمعين من أول يوم ظلمهم إلى قيام يوم الدين أما بعد السلام عليك سيدي ومولاي يا أبا عبد الله وعلى الأرواح التي حلت بفنائك عليك مني سلام الله أبدا ما بقيت وبقي الليل والنهار ولا جعله الله آخر العهد مني لزيارتكم السلام على الحسين وعلى علي بن الحسين وعلى أولاد الحسين وعلى أصحاب الحسين جميعا ورحمة الله وبركاته قال الله العظيم في كتابه الكريم وهو أحسن القائلين وأصدق الصادقين بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم يا أيها الذين آمنوا إذا قيل لكم تفسحوا في المجالس فافسحوا يفسح الله لكم وإذا قيل انشزوا فانشزوا يرفع الله الذين آمنوا منكم والذين أوتوا العلم درجات آمنا بالله صدق الله العلي العظيم For the purification of the souls and the enlightenment of the hearts and for the hastening of the reappearance of the awaited Savior عجل الله تعالى فرجه الشريف Enlighten your souls and the atmosphere with the recitation of salawat upon Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad Respected elders, brothers and sisters, salamun alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. It is organized in its thousands in many parts across the globe, attended by millions of human beings on an annual basis, held across different languages, cultures, denominations, under one banner and one purpose. The Majalis of the grandson of the Holy Prophet, Sayyid al-Shuhada, Aba Abdullah al-Husayn, salawatullahi wa salamu alayhi. Are an important part of the calendar of many believers across the world. You find that the Majalis, these gatherings of commemoration, are held in many parts of this particular planet. You'll find them held from São Paulo in Brazil, from Perth in Australia, from Qatar, towards many parts. The commemoration of Sayyid al-Shuhada is held in order to uphold the principles of the University of Ashura, and at the same time for people to pay their respects and stand in admiration from the sacrifice of this great individual. When you look at this idea of majalis and the concept of a majlis, people like to establish them throughout their lives. You'll find majalis held in congregation. Sometimes individuals want to have majalis in their own residence. Sometimes people hold majalis in order to remember those who have passed away. Majalis, therefore, are integral in the lives of many human beings. That the question is, this concept of majalis, what is the root of it and the basis of it in the religion of Islam? Because when you look at this word majlis, it means a gathering. It refers to a congregation of people. When we look at the Holy Quran, people ask the question, has this notion of majalis been mentioned in the Quran? Has it been referred to in the Quran or not? An individual who picks up the holy book, the immaculate, error-free words of the Almighty subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Holy Quran, will come to the conclusion that the idea of majalis and the establishment of these gatherings has been mentioned and referred to in many instances. Yes, the word majalis is found once in the Quran, in chapter 58, Surah Al-Mujadala. Yet in other chapters, we'll find what? We'll find references which are connected to the way majalis should be upheld and should be organized. Under which category does this fall? This falls under the recommendations that Islam puts forward in the area known as adab. When we come to analyze the way human beings interact with each other in society, there is a science known as etiquettes and mannerism. This constitutes the way people interact with each other. Many a times people love to interact with an individual who is well-mannered, who observes good etiquettes. Definitely it's a universal virtue. The notion of adab is something that many people admire when it comes to a system, when it comes to a way that people practice their lives. The idea that emerges is this, that today in a society that we live in, there is a need to look at the concept of adab. The Holy Quran examines this notion in many verses. The teachings of the Ahlul Bayt, the pure and immaculate progeny of the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. Look at the concept of adab, etiquettes and mannerisms in many ways, through many different angles. The Quran looks at majalis through the lens of adab, etiquettes. In which way? People come forward and say, what is an adab? What is an etiquette? Some ulama of akhlaq, they come forward and say, etiquettes are those practices that involve struggle, self-scrutinization, refining of the soul in order to display righteousness and to stay away from that which constitutes evil and wrong. That which involves effort, that which involves struggle, is known as adab. Some say no, an adab is the epitome and one of the highest levels of akhlaq. So they make a separation between akhlaq and adab, between ethics and mannerism. They say adab is makarimul akhlaq. The highest levels of morality is adab, etiquettes and mannerisms. Third group of scholars, they say the definition of adab is what? Is whatever good traits the human beings develop as second nature within their existence, known as malaka in the Arabic language. If something becomes part and parcel of us, if it becomes something what we do not necessarily think about, we act there and therein. In other words, it is not something that we force ourselves to do. It's part of our behavior. People, some of the scholars classify this under what? Under adab. That's why we find the Holy Prophet of Islam, Rasul al-A'bam Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. Famous narration, أَدَّبَنِي رَبِّي فَأَحْسَنَ تَأْدِيبِي, that my Lord has taught me adab and he has indeed perfected this. Likewise, the Prophet of Islam has narrated and has mentioned the following. He says, أَنَا أَدِيبُ اللَّهِ, Allah has taught me adab. Wa aliyun adibi. And I have taught Ali this adab. Yes, this is quite clearly established when we come to Amir al-Mu'mineen wa Imam al-Muttaqeen Ali ibn Abi Talib salawatullahi wa salamu alayhi. Amir al-Mu'mineen comes forward and says what? He says Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has what? Has taught the Prophet adab. And the Prophet has taught me adab, wa ana adibul mu'minin, and I teach the believers adab. In other words, what? There is emphasis in the school of Ahlul Bayt in this crucial concept that we are in need of discussing and looking at in this day, arguably more than other times. Why? Today there is a distinct lack of morality, respect and following of etiquettes in many corners around the world. There are studies and surveys conducted in the United States that say 76% of the American population believe that the majority of the 20 and 30 year olds today lack the etiquettes and the mannerisms that people had in the past. More so, many of those questioned, they say this is because of the development of celebrity culture. The idea of imitating these superstars, these individuals who in many occasions lack these etiquettes and what? Moral traits. The Ahlul Bayt alayhum as-salam have developed and presented for you and I a system of etiquettes and manners. Many a times their lives are what? Manifestation of the greatest way in which the human being can lead their lives. Not only when it comes to obedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but to be model citizens in whatever they are. You look at the Ahlul Bayt alayhum as-salam and you are mesmerized. These adab are not necessarily wajib, but they elevate the individual in the eyes of Allah as well as human beings. This is crucial for us to understand. Look at the Ahlul Bayt, each and every one of them was the crystallization of the best adab anyone can ever see. You look at Sayyid al-Shuhada, Aba Abdullah al-Husayn, salawatullahi wa salamu alayhi. People would come to him knowing that his house is the house of generosity. It's the house whereby they would not leave disappointed, no doubt. Someone will come to him and ask for money. Imam alayhi salam would go inside the house, come out, but would not open the door fully, would extend his hands with the bag of money and gives it to that poor individual. The person inside the house is whom? Qambar. Qambar, the servant of Amir al-Mu'mineen. He narrates, he said, I said to him, oh my master, ya Aba Abdullah, why did you not open the door fully and give this man what he has requested? Aba Abdullah said, it is because he came to me asking, and I felt that if I give it to him by looking at his eyes, that might make him what? In the state of humiliation. I wanted to keep his izzah, his dignity. Therefore, I gave it behind the door so he does not feel any lower. This is one of the adab of giving for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Isn't it? That the Ahlul Bayt alayhum as-salam, today we have books written on etiquettes and manners known as adab. Everything that we do as Islam is a comprehensive system of life has what? Recommendations as far as what we should be doing in order to fragrance our deeds with that which constitutes good mannerism. What do we mean? You look at actions such as wearing clothes, eating, drinking, going to the restroom, sleeping. All these, there are recommendations known as what? Etiquettes and adab. I give you one example. We are told from the teachings of the Ahlul Bayt that the believer sleeping is something everybody does. It is not wajib to do the following, but what does it do? It indeed increases the tendency towards spirituality when the individual inculcates these teachings and recommendations in their lives and practices what the holy Ahlul Bayt would practice, for instance, before they go to sleep. Meaning what? We are told that the Ahlul Bayt would say, before we go to sleep, we should empty our bladder. We should perform the wudu. We should recite isti'adha, a'udhu billahi min ash-shaytan ar-rajim. We should sleep in a way that what? That when we sit up, we are facing the Qibla. We should not be sleeping on our stomachs, because that type of sleep is the sleep of the shaitan. We should be sleeping either on our backs or on our sides. And we should be reciting certain recommended chapters of the Quran before we sleep. Such as we are told the Prophet of Islam used to recite Surah Al-Takathur, Surah Al-Ikhlas, Surah Al-Kafirun. These are recommended before we sleep. Likewise, the Ahlul Bayt would say, before we sleep, you should recite Tasbih at Fatima to Zahra, salawatullahi wa salamu alayhi. When we look at these adab, and when we start teaching our children from a young age, when they see their parents performing it, when they see their parents emphasizing it in this day and age whereby we are struggling and we are being confronted by this lack of morality in many parts of the world, not only in the Western world, where the children have disrespect for their elders, they have disrespect, some of them, for their parents, for their teachers, they answer them back, they use their first name of the teacher of their father to refer back to them. There is what? A distinct lack of morality and ethics. It must start at home, practiced by the parents, inspired by the Ahlul Bayt. That is very important for us to appreciate and what? To understand and begin to practice where? In our lives as much as we can. Yet when we come to this notion of majalis, this is the sphere in which the Holy Quran describes the notion and the concept of majalis. You look at, for instance, chapter 4, verse 84. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about the idea of greeting and responding back to the greeting. The Almighty subhanahu wa ta'ala says that when you are greeted, you must respond back with either what should be said or even better. Meaning that when we are in a particular gathering, when we are in a particular setting and we have individuals entering and they recite the salam, we must what? Respond back with the salam. And the Quran says it is better to even add more. It is even to say, for instance, alaykum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Why? It is also what? Part of the recommendations, part of the adab, part of the etiquettes. Yet the idea or the subject matter of our discussion is what? Is the verse in chapter 58, Surah Al-Mujadala, whereby Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala refers to the word majalis. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم يا أيها الذين آمنوا إذا قيل لكم تفسحوا في المجالس فافسحوا يفسح الله لكم. What's the cause of revelation for the only ayah in which the word majalis has been referred to? We are told that the Holy Prophet of Islam, peace and blessings be upon him and his holy progeny, was in the holy city of Medina in his Masjid al-Nabawi. In Masjid al-Nabawi, there is an area known as As-Suffa. As-Suffa is a place where the poor often would sit requesting for help and need. They would wait for some provisions, for some people who would have some money or food, and would give these individuals who were considered destitute and needy. Yet sometimes it was also used by the Prophet of Islam as an opportunity to congregate and to preach, to disseminate, to deliver the teachings of the religion. So one day we are told the Holy Prophet was with a group of people speaking about the beautiful religion and the instructions set out in the Holy Quran. it was packed in this area of Suffa, next to what? Inside the Masjid al-Nabawi, close to the mihrab of the Holy Prophet. We are told all of a sudden a group of people who had fought in Badr, some of the Sahaba that had taken part in the famous battle of Badr, entered and came to this area. They greeted the people who were sitting. They greeted them by saying Salamun Alaikum. And the people, as well as of course the Prophet of Islam, responded and reciprocated their greeting. Yet what happened? They stood there, there was no space for them to sit. They looked around, there was nowhere for them to join this particular majlis, this congregation, this gathering of people. There was nowhere for them to sit. It was very difficult for them. They stood there not knowing what to do. The Prophet of Islam, his heart is full of love and mercy. And all that he wants is what? Is to feel compassionate for the people. Therefore, he became upset by the fact that no one was prepared to somehow make space for them. So what did he do? He said to a few of those who are sitting, please stand up and leave some space for these particular individuals to sit down. There were some munafiqeen sitting. You see, munafiqeen, they did not wait for Facebook to come. You know, back in the time, they were there. It is not, we need some social media venture in order for us to spread rumors. The munafiqeen came out and said, look at this man. You call him a just individual, yet he raised certain people who were not from the individuals who fought in Badr, and he made those who fought in the battle sit instead of them. Therefore, he's not just. They started spreading these rumors in society. Yes? And within the areas in the holy city of Medina, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed this set of verses, including this one, highlighting a number of key features. O you who believe, if it is told to you, make space in a majlis, make space. Yes? When people come in, this also happens sometimes in very congregated places, such as Masjid al-Haram next to the Holy Kaaba, or in other places next to the shrines of the Ahl al-Bayt, alayhum as-salam. You and I have seen, those who have not been, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant you opportunity to either perform Hajj or Umrah and the ziyarah of the Ahl al-Bayt, alayhum as-salam. We are told when you're there, sometimes what happens, especially on the busy days and nights, people sit there and sometimes they have what? Their belongings. Yes? Or when they stand for namaz, Allahu Akbar. Some of them are practicing yoga in salah. Yes? They spread like this. They take so much space. The Quran says, when it is told to you, make space, then obey. Yes? Allow people to be able to sit. Now, the first thing that should come to your mind now is, the Quran is talking about something which many of us think is trivial. To speak about making space in a majlis, the Quran has talked about this particular issue, that when people come in a gathering and there's no space and it is told to you, congregate, get a bit closer, allow them to sit, then you must do so. Yes, it does. Why? It is trying to highlight what? A key feature, and that is what? And that is the notion of love and respect and assistance to others, but above all, the idea of etiquette, the idea of mannerism. So when it comes to this particular ayah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, "Tafassahu yafsahillahu lakum." Now when you make space for others, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will also expand things for you. Ulama have come forward and said, how will Allah expand things for people? Number one, by expanding their rizq and their sustenance in dunya, by providing them with more than they ever thought. Allah says, you know, make space for people in a majlis and I will give you more in your world. You know, just people might think this is trivial, but the Quran is saying, no, it is not trivial. It's an act of principle and at the same time, adab. Secondly, people have said expansion not only in dunya. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will not only increase the rizq, but He will also increase the area of Jannah for people to live in. In other words, the reward in Akhirah would also be indeed great. The Quran then says, وَإِذَا قِيلَ انْشُزُوا فَانْشُزُوا. When it is said to you, stand up, you must stand up. Nushuz here is in reference to standing up. Some people say, some of the Mufassireen have come forward and said, this standing up could either be taken literally, that in a majlis, in a gathering, please, when there are people who are elderly or there are people who are looking difficult to find a space, then either stand up, move forward, congregate together and make space for them. Or it means sometimes in gatherings, maybe you have been there too long and allow others to take your space instead. I tell you, those who have been to Masjid al-Nabawi today, in this area, this blessed area known as Al-Rawdha, Al-Rawdha al-Sharifa in Masjid al-Nabawi, it's a place between the holy grave of the Prophet and the minbar. ما بين قبري ومنبري روضة من رياض الجنة. Yes, it is mentioned by the ulama that it is part of Jannah, this particular Rawdha, this area. You'll find it so difficult to find space. Why? Because someone has come there, they have recited two rakat namaz. And they think, you know, another two rakat namaz. My goodness, after 2 hours, they're still reciting two rakat namaz. And you're thinking, but surely you should allow opportunity. It is a small space for others. Surely you should give opportunity for others. This is in reference to the idea that back in the time, what they used to do with the Prophet and the Ahlul Bayt alayhim salam, some of the people, they would come to ask him a question and they would sit there. And they would ask another question and they would sit there. And the Prophet and the Ahlul Bayt were so kind and warm-hearted that they would not want to say to someone, excuse me, I think you know you have stayed too much. There are many people, others who are also wanting to have their queries, their questions dealt with. You are staying too much. They would not necessarily want to hurt that individual. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala here is saying, you know, sometimes you should know the limits. You should not stay, overstay, stand up and leave. Why? Because this is in reference to the idea that when you are there, utilize your time, but don't waste it. Why? Because some people used to come to the Prophet and ask him useless questions. Like once someone asked the Prophet, Ya Rasulullah, is my father in Jannah or is he in hell? The Prophet of Islam is there to solve people's problems. Yet this, it's like someone asked an alim one day, he said, Maulana, I have a very important question that is killing me. He said, really? What is it that's killing you? He said, I cannot sleep. He said, what is the problem? He said, you know, in the wedding of Adam and Eve, what did they have? What was the walima? The alim said, I have an answer. He said, what is it? He said, well, I wasn't invited, so I don't know. Sometimes people want to waste time by questions which are what? The Quran says, the answer of which may harm you more than do you good. يا أيها الذين آمنوا لا تسألوا عن أشياء إن تبد لكم تسؤكم. O you who believe, do not ask about certain things in which the answer may what result in more harm for you than good. May not be something that you are necessarily what looking for. But the key feature is this. The Quran says, يَرْفَعِ اللَّهُ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا مِنْكُمْ وَالَّذِينَ أُوتُوا الْعِلْمَ دَرَجَاتٍ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala here is talking about a magnificent notion. The idea that yes, there are etiquettes in a majalis, but why should there be this particular emphasis on making space, especially in this area that the Prophet of Islam had told people to stand up? They were people of knowledge and understanding. Allah says, Allah raises those who are believers and have knowledge many degrees. Of course, when it comes to ilm, the notion of seeking knowledge in Islam, there is so much emphasis. Not, when it comes to this idea, we are fascinated by the notion that the first word revealed to the Holy Prophet is what? Iqra, read. Yes, the first word encourages the seeking of knowledge. Amir al-Mu'mineen wa Imam al-Muttaqeen Ali ibn Abi Talib salawatullahi wa salamu alayhi. would come forward and say, "Talabul ilmi khair." The seeking of knowledge is righteousness. Wal jahlu shar. And being ignorant is what? Is an individual who is not looking for their enlightenment. In other words, it is the source of being misled and going astray. No doubt there is so much emphasis about the seeking of knowledge in the religion of Islam. Yet within the context of this ayah, one important notion emerges, and I would like your attention to this. And that is the role and the respect and the honor the religion of Islam reserves for scholars and those seeking knowledge. Because ayah after ayah, narration after narration, points us towards this important realization. Listen to the following. The Prophet of Islam says, "Al-ulama warathatul anbiya." The prophets are the inheritors. The ulama, the scholars, are the inheritors of the prophets. Yes, our holy fifth Imam, Imam Muhammad ibn al-Baqir, salawatullahi wa salamu alayhi. Mentions, it is narrated that he said, "Alimun yuntafa'u min ilmih afdalu min 70 alf abid." A scholar in which the knowledge is beneficially or a beneficial aspect to community is better in the eyes of Allah than 70,000 worshippers. Yes. Also, narrations say on the day of judgment, the ink of the scholars will be placed on one scale and the blood of the martyrs on the other scale, and the ink of the scholars will be heavier than the blood of the martyrs. We are told in a magnificent narration, the Prophet of Islam says, "Fadlu al-alimi ala al-abid kafadli alaykum." If you forget all the narrations, remember this. The status of a scholar over a worshipper who is not a scholar, the rank or the superiority in the eyes of Allah is like the superiority of the Prophet of Islam over others. Yes? This is the degree and the sensitive nature of the status of scholars within the religion of Islam, within the teachings of the religion of Islam. We have thousands of scholars within the school of Ahl al-Bayt, past and present, who have sacrificed their lives, who have given us everything so that we can hold Majalis today, no doubt. They have done whatever they can, written hundreds of books, given and disseminated the ulum of Ali Muhammad in order for us to be enlightened and in order for us to carry the message and the flag forward. Scholar after scholar, whom many of us have not necessarily studied their lives, whom many of us have not necessarily heard of their names. People like Al-Akhund Al-Khurasani, who is the author of a famous book known as Al-Kifaya. This is studied where? In Hawza. It's a book of the Usul, the principles of jurisprudence. Yes, this particular scholar, he was poor. He was in Iran. He moved towards Tehran. He wanted to go to Najaf. He wanted to study in Najaf, yet he did not have the means to do so. He came to someone. He said, "Is there prayers or fasting that I can do on behalf of someone and get paid for it?" He was told, "Yes, there is someone who's passed away. There is a need to perform fasting and prayers for 20 years for him, and you will be paid 100 tumans." What's 100 tumans? Nothing really. At that time, maybe it was something that gets you by for 20 years of prayers and fasting. Yes, 20 times months of Ramadan. This particular great scholar is a mujtahid. He would perform this so that he would get paid, so that he would travel. He would travel to Najaf. He would have a class attended by hundreds. He would write this book that is today studied by the ulama in Al-Hawza. Yet for many years he's continuing to perform this salah and this psalm that he had to take in order to what? To fund his own education or his struggle for ilm. Likewise, we have examples of scholars who have given their lives, many, in order for the teachings of the Ahlul Bayt to reach us. We are told that many years ago in India, there were a couple of scholars who sacrificed their lives. Why? There was apparently a sultan in part of an India known as Ibrahim Shah. He hated the Shia. He hated the followers of the Ahlul Bayt. We are told two scholars from Shiraz, they came there. Slowly they began to preach the teachings of the school of Ahlul Bayt, until they even influenced the son of the sultan. They influenced him. This was over 500 years ago. They influenced the son until he found out. He executed both of these scholars from the school of Ahlul Bayt, and what? And sent his son away in order for him not to influence others. Yet we are told when he passed away, this particular sultan, his son would return, inspired by these scholars, and would work to spread the teachings of the Ahlul Bayt in that part of India, which what? Helped to increase the number of the followers of the Ahlul Bayt. Therefore we find scholar after scholar who would give everything in order for what? For the teachings to reach us. Why is this important? Because today, let me be honest and frank with you, today there is a dangerous movement out there seeking to undermine and to attack and fabricate and distort the image of scholars, especially those within the school of Ahlul Bayt. Where is this found? Social media. Where is this found? Satellite channels. Where is this found? In certain books and publications. Yes, someone would come out and say, this particular individual, I don't think he's a marja, I don't think he's a mujtahid, I think he has no knowledge. Another individual would post and say, this particular individual sits on the minbar but has no knowledge. This particular individual speaks nonsense and rubbish. There is so much out there that is what? That truly hurts us. When we look at what's going on as far as some people's audacity to left, right, and center attack the scholars, attack the speakers, attack those who are serving the majalis of Aba Abdullah and the member of Rasulullah. They have the audacity to come out and they say this and that and criticize publicly, wanting to what? Wanting to weaken this particular institution. In their mind, why do they do it? Either because of hatred, either because of jealousy, either because of an agenda that they may particularly have. But unfortunately, we find social media has spread with this type of sentiment to weaken people's connection with the ulama, to somehow break the bond with the maraji', with our scholars, with those who give everything for the sake of the religion, for the sake of spreading of the madhab of Ahlul Bayt. Don't get me wrong, they're not ma'sumeen, these scholars. But there is a way, there are etiquettes in which we what criticize. In which way? That we come forward, we speak to them directly, we send them a message. Not that I come publicly and post and say, this particular individual, I found him somewhere and taking a selfie with this and doing that. In other words, trying to what? Trying to distort and present a negative image in the eyes of people about certain individuals, about certain scholars who are trying to what? To spread the teachings of Ali Muhammad. And that's why it's very, very important for us to appreciate that this ayah that is concerning majalis is talking about the significance of ulama, is talking about the importance of the etiquettes of majalis, knowing that our fourth imam, Imam Zain al-Abidin al-Sajjad, salawatullahi wa salamu alayhi, would come forward and say in his famous sermon, where? In the courtyard of Yazid, in which he would eulogize the epic of Karbala and what happened on the 10th, he would come forward and say that when it comes to the message, when it comes to delivering what should be delivered, there are two things to keep in mind. The first is what? Is whatever pleases Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And second, it must be beneficial for the community. These two are key features for whom? For those who are delivering the message, for the ulama, for the speakers to keep in mind, no doubt. Yet the majalis themselves should definitely continue. And they have an active role in society and in many communities. But the concept of majlis is not confined to what? To one particular area. We find the fourth imam saying what? In his supplications. That there are also two kinds of majalis. The majalis of death and the majalis of life. These are concepts in the Holy Quran. In which way? The majalis of death is not in reference to the commemoration when someone passes away. No. The majalis of death, majalisul maut, is areas and gatherings in which the heart dies due to backbiting, due to slandering, due to distortion and fabrication and spreading rumors. These are the majalis in which people are what? Further and further away from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And majalisul hayat are majalisul dhikr. That's why the Holy Prophet of Islam, Rasul al-Azam Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. Would say, make sure that you go to the area of Jannah. Make sure you go and you spend time in area of Jannah. They would say to him, which area is this? Where can we find it? He goes, wherever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is remembered. These are the areas of dhikrullah. The mentioning of the Almighty subhanahu wa ta'ala, whatever reminds people about the absolute perfect being, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Our fourth imam says in dua Abu Hamza, Sayyidi wa Mawlai bi dhikrika aasha qalbi. With your remembrance, my heart is alive. Indeed, the Quran tells us, Ya ayyuhal ladhina amanu istajibu lillahi wa lirrasool, idha da'a lima yuhyikum, answer the call of Allah and His Messenger to that which gives you life. So there is the concept of majalis of maut. Majalis of maut is what? Is those which involve wasting time, killing time, that which involves dealing about the lives of others, backbiting and slandering. Whereas the majalis of dhikr are those which involves the remembrance of Almighty subhanahu wa ta'ala. The gatherings in which the individual attending leaves one step closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That is the barometer. Next time you're anywhere, you're sitting with any person, this is a majlis. Yes? There's etiquette, there are adab. Consider this. Imam Zain al-Abideen says, it's either a majlis in which you get life, or what? A majlis in which your heart dies. When you leave, are you closer to Allah or further away from the Almighty subhanahu wa ta'ala? How many steps have we got forward? How many steps have we retracted when we are in gatherings? Yes, that's why even if we are gatherings at home, when we have family over, it is so recommended to have what? Some mentioning of the Almighty subhanahu wa ta'ala, some recitation of the Quran, some remembrance of the Ahl al-Bayt. Why? Because we are told the remembrance of the Ahl al-Bayt is one of the greatest manifestations of dhikrullah azza wa jal. Why? Because it gets us closer to Allah. These are individuals who gave everything for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. An individual comes forward and says, I do not understand how this one important day, the day of Ashura, the 10th of Muharram, the impact of it has reached far and wide around the world, and people congregate in these gatherings. They come together in these majalis remembering the tragedy of Ashura, remembering the sacrifice of Aba Abdullah al-Hussein, where they do so due to their own free will and nobody forces them. Nobody tells you, you must attend the majalis. People flock in their millions across the world to attend in many corners. These are greatest demonstrations of the majalis of dhikrullah, of the remembrance of the Almighty subhanahu wa ta'ala. Someone says, why is this the case? Yes, why are people so drawn and inspired by Aba Abdullah? Someone responded and said, Hussein gave his heart completely to Allah. Allah gives the heart of humanity to Hussein. Yes, indeed, that is the case. That's why when we look at the majalis of the remembrance of the Ahl al-Bayt, we are told in narrations, these particular majalis are majalis in which the malaika perform istighfar for those who are remembering the merits of the Ahl al-Bayt. Yes, one narration states that malaika, certain angels, went up to the heavens after they were on the earth. The other angels smelt fragrance from them. They said, where were you? Why do you smell so nice? They responded and said, we were in a gathering, in a majlis, in which the family of the Prophet were remembered, in which people honored the Ahl al-Bayt. The malaika who were not there, they descend on that place. They see people have left. People are no longer there, but they see the fragrance is still there. So they are able to fragrance themselves from this particular remembrance. That's why our sixth Imam, Imam Ja'far ibn Muhammad and As-Sadiq, salawatullahi wa salamu alayhi, mentions a famous hadith where he asks his companions, أَتَجْلُسُونَ وَتَتَحَدَّثُونَ? Do you sit? Tajlusun here comes with the idea of sitting. Do you sit in congregations and you speak about us? They say, Bala, Yabna Rasulullah. Of course, O grandson of the Holy Prophet. The Imam would smile and say, by God, inni uhibbu tilkal majalis. I love these gatherings. Ahyu amrana, rahimallahu man ahya amrana. Revive our affairs. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant you what? Grant you life in your heart and grant you mercy because of this particular revival. That's why the ulama have continued on the path of the Ahl al-Bayt in terms of the emphasis to establish the majalis of Aba Abdullah al-Hussein. Everywhere around the world, the key emphasis on this continues, and no doubt it's growing from strength to strength in terms of the numbers, in terms of the locations, in terms of the content. When it comes to these particular majalis, the ulama have spoken about them in many ways. For instance, we are told that one particular alim, Ayatullah al-Udma al-Mar'ashi Najafi, Ridwanullahi ta'ala alayhi, he would put in his will, when I die, bury me with the handkerchief that I used to carry when I attend the majalis of Aba Abdullah. Look at the emphasis. He would say, this handkerchief would help me in alam al-barzakh. Because of what? Because of the majalis. Another great individual, another great scholar would say that what? He would come forward and say, the majalis of Aba Abdullah are the extensions from the haram of Hussein in Karbala. They extend. They are like a tree and the branches. The majalis everywhere are the extensions of this haram. Yes, and those who attend the majalis are like those who are performing the ziyarah of Aba Abdullah. Yes, they are commemorating this great message. They are standing in honor of this particular sacrifice. That's why some people ask, why every year? Why there is emphasis upon holding these majalis and remembering and crying and weeping? Because it does not take much to come to the conclusion that these majalis inspire, these majalis change lives, these majalis transform the human being. They are a great station in the year for the human being to rediscover their connection with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I told one particular individual, he was a thief, he was a bandit several hundred years ago. He used to earn his living by stopping caravans on the way in Arabia, and he would steal alongside his friends whatever they had. One day, one of his friends said to him, let's go to a majlis of Aba Abdullah. It was Muharram. He said, you know what? I'm not in a position to go to a majlis. I'm not someone who is interested, to be honest. I'd rather continue doing what I do. His friend, though, would not let him go. He said, you don't have to do anything. We'll go to this particular majlis. You just sit there and that's all. See, there is benefit in just attending the majlis. To start off with, when you and I enter a place in which Aba Abdullah al-Hussein is remembered and mourned, there is what? There is significance, there is barakah, there is spirituality to start off with. Even though if we refuse to take and to implement the teachings in our lives, we attain some reward and there is some positive impact on our souls. Definitely, no doubt. So this particular individual, he says, I attended the majlis, I sat. The scholar was talking about repentance and tawbah. And he spoke about how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's doors are open. He mentioned the idea that no one should be despondent. And he emphasized the need for us to re-scrutinize our actions and turn to him subhanahu wa ta'ala. This individual, the thief, said, I was inspired. I had lost hope, but when I heard these words from the particular scholar, what happened? I thought, that's it. I cannot continue doing what I do. Therefore, he sought tawbah and repentance. He came to the scholar. He said to him, can I seek forgiveness from Almighty? He says, of course, these majalis are a great opportunity to return back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is one of the reasons why Aba Abdullah al-Hussein sacrificed everything that he had in order for us to reconnect with our faith, with our principles, with our values. And therefore, the door of tawbah is open for you. This man said, I said, that's it. I will no longer steal from people. He said, I went back home. I told my wife. She said, very well, but we need some food. Go out and find a job. He said, I went in the market until I found a construction place to build. They said to me, you take part in this job and we give you 1 dirham a day. He said, I went back with the dirham. I put it on the table. My wife said that yesterday when you were stealing, we used to get 3,000 a day. Now it's 1. This is very difficult. He said, well, that's it. This path is very difficult. He said, I was patient 1 day, 2 days, 3 days, 1 week, 1 month, until my children were hungry. My wife was complaining. I said, you know what? Maybe this is not for me. Let me go back. You know, sometimes some people have necessarily weakness in their willpower. So he said, I will go back. He went back to his friends. After he told them, I'm stopped. He said, look, I'm ready back to resume my thieving. We went to a particular place in the desert waiting for a caravan. A caravan came, we stopped them, we took everything from them. But then some of my friends said, these people have seen us. They will tell the authorities about us. There is no way other than to kill them all. We have to kill them in order for them not to report us. He said, I was thinking with myself, I attended that majlis. That idea of tawbah, there was this spark in my heart. I could not go and kill these people. I could not do it. He said, I said to them, leave them all to me. I go behind the mountain and I will kill them. Don't worry, I'll do it. I said, yeah, very well, go. He said, I took them, a group of men, women and children. I went behind, we took them behind a mountain. I looked at them and said, you know what? I'm someone who's asking Allah to forgive me. But I am weak and I've gone back to stealing. Therefore, I do not wish to commit more sins. I want to free you. You all go, but go quickly because I do not want my friends to know that I have not killed you. I want you all to be saved. So go. So they all started running and going. One of them turned back to me and said, look, oh man, you have saved our lives. I want to give you something. He said, what is it? He said, you know, in the animals that you all have captured, there is a black donkey. Nobody would want this donkey. I have stuffed a special bag somewhere hidden in within the bags. It has much gold in it. This is my gift for you. Take it. Yes? He said, I went back. My friend said, what would you like from all that we have taken? He said, I just want the black donkey. That's it. He said, that black donkey, no one wants it. He said, that's that one. He said, I took it. I saw that that is in it. But then I went home and I said, you know what? If it wasn't for that one majlis I had attended, I would have probably killed these individuals. I would have done whatever. Look at the impact of the majlis and that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has what has helped me. Even now I have attained some rizq, which is what halal that this man has given it for me. Therefore, he repented, and this time he would never go back, and he would be one of those who would establish the majalis of Abu Abdullah al-Husayn. That's why we find that when we look at the concept of majalis, there are etiquettes when it comes to majlis to end with. There are things for us to keep in mind in order for us, and our attendance in these majalis is what? Is one that is the cause for us to attain thawab and reward. What are the etiquettes? Some of the etiquettes and the adab of the majalis of Abu Abdullah al-Husayn. Very briefly, the ones associated with those who establish the majalis and those who attend them. Number one, sincerity. Meaning what? Meaning, why is it that we attend the majalis? Why is it that we are making the effort to be in those places? It must be purely for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in order for us to stand and to what? Share the grief with Fatima al-Zahra. Yes? Share the grief with the master of our time and start to feel the pain and the suffering that they would go through when they would hear about what happened on the 10th of Muharram. Sincerity is of the utmost importance, that we attend and we organize majalis and we speak and do everything, not for us to, for instance, get a particular position, not for us to be known as somebody who comes during the 10 days of Muharram, or to be known as religious or whatever, but importantly for the sake of Allah, and within this bracket to revive the affairs of the Ahlul Bayt. Because one businessman in Iran, one day someone came to him and said, excuse me, I have a majlis of Abu Abdullah, I need some help, donation, can you help me? He said, no problem. He had a checkbook. He said, how much, he signed it. He said, put in it how much you want. He said, what, empty? I could put whatever? He said, yes. He said, but why don't you look? Why don't you tell me how much? He said, you put, this is for majlis for Abu Abdullah. Don't stipulate. Put whatever you want, and I have signed it. He said, but even when you have signed it, you have not put on your glasses. You know, you don't want. He said, yes, because I do not want to see how much it is. I want to sign it, and you take it. Later on, when he passed away, someone saw him in the dream, this businessman. He said to him, how are you in Alam al-Barzakh? He said, I am feeling fantastic. It's great. He said, why? They said to him, why? He said, I did not wear my glasses for the majalis of Hussein. The malaika did not wear their glasses for my sins. Yes? So majalis of Abu Abdullah, it is definitely one of sincerity. Number one. Number two, when it comes to the way we present ourselves in the majalis, the dress code, the hijab, all should be in respect of what we are honoring. We are honoring the sacrifice of this great lady, Sayyida Zainab, who did everything to uphold the principles of hijab and modesty and chastity. Number two. Number three of great importance is what? Shaitan sometimes comes what? Amidst us in these majalis and makes us forget that we are in special places in remembrance of the Ahlul Bayt. Therefore, the chatting, the gossiping, the backbiting, the unnecessary dissecting of other people's lives. We have to be very careful, because yes, we are attaining reward and thawab, lest we lose it by what? By displeasing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala through these particular statements, through these particular small what? Actions, small I mean in terms of gatherings in which people sit together, perhaps after the majlis, perhaps when they leave, perhaps when they come, perhaps after the majlis, when they go home, in order for them to backbite, God forbid, or to mention someone in an unacceptable way. Likewise, there is a key element of the etiquettes of the majalis of Abu Abdullah, and that is what? To make sure that the majalis are making an impact in our lives. That means that sometimes one hadith, one ayah, one sentence, one story is something great. Tell me, please, think about it yourself. How many majalis have we attended in our lives? And if we sit there and someone shows us a video of our lives and all the majalis that we have attended, we think, wow, it's been so many years. But how many of them we have actually actively gone and written down some of the key features that we feel are important for our betterment in our lives? How many of them we have made notes so that it helps us and it helps our children in the future? How many of these majalis we have left thinking there is a practical point that I must apply in my life? These are all key features and etiquettes of indeed what? The majalis of Aba Abdullah. The attendance of the majalis is necessary, because in this day and age, one of the adab is what? One of the adab of the majalis is the idea of to be in this particular gathering, to ask about others, to listen directly. Because sometimes people say, you know what, there is this live stream now. Majalis at home, with a cup of coffee and some biscuit, and alhamdulillah, everything is good. And I would listen to it live on the TV screen or on the computer. There are now smart TVs. I can do this. We have to be careful. Yes, it's a good facility for people who can't make it, who might be far, who might have young children, the elderly. But those who are coming back from work, thinking, you know what, I'm tired, or I don't have necessarily the stamina today, let me stay at home. This is dangerous. What we have to continue doing, despite the attempts of our enemies, despite the ones who walk into Husayniyas and blow themselves up, despite the attempts of those online and the others who are trying to question this concept, we attend to say that nobody and nothing can stop us from the remembrance of Aba Abdullah al-Husayn. Yes, the attendance is of the utmost importance. The impact that you and I would have when listening to something directly is much more than having it when we're sitting in front of a TV screen or in front of a computer screen. Indeed, and finally, the etiquette with regards to those who are delivering the majalis is definitely one that involves speaking about that which brings people closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the Ahlul Bayt, that which is beneficial to the people, that which does not cause friction and what division in society and in community, that which indeed helps people spiritually, theologically, and helps them understand their faith, increases community cohesion and brings the hearts together. That's why we are told the Ahlul Bayt alayhum as-salam would continuously emphasize the remembrance of Aba Abdullah and the upholding of the majalis. Our eighth imam would say to the famous companion Ibn Shabib, he would say, oh Ibn Shabib, do you know what kind of days these are? These are the days of Muharram, O Ibn Shabib. Make your heart saddened over the loss of Aba Abdullah, because those who grieve for our grief and are happy for the days of our happiness are those who are truly our followers. Yet he says to him, O Ibn Shabib, let me tell you that the family of my grandfather Aba Abdullah were slaughtered just like sheep are slaughtered. But I tell him, O Imam, the sheep are normally slaughtered by after being fed water, isn't it? That the fourth Imam would walk on the streets of Medina seeing sheep about to be slaughtered. He says to the man, have you fed this animal water? The man would say, Ibn Rasulillah, there is no way that we can slaughter the animal without feeding them water. Imam would say, my father and the companions and the Ahlul Bayt on the 10th of Muharram were slaughtered thirsty. That's why Aba Abdullah al-Husayn, when leaving the city of Medina, he would bid farewell to his holy grandfather, the Prophet of Islam. He would sit next to the grave. He would mourn. He would cry. He would try to connect with Rasulullah. He would fall asleep, and in his dream he would see the Prophet of Islam. The Prophet would say to him, oh Hussein, there is a position for you in the eyes of Allah that will never be attained except shahada through martyrdom. Aba Abdullah says to him, Ya Rasulullah, my grandfather, take me towards you. I do not wish to go back to dunya. Allow me to remain with you. The Prophet said, oh my son Hussein, not
only will you be slaughtered with your family and your companions, but your women will be taken as slaves.
Allahu Akbar. Imam al-Hussein also bids farewell to his mother Fatima al-Zahra, sits next to her hidden grave, weeps and cries. Yes, and he's trying to leave the city of Medina, yet he looks at one particular young girl. Her name is Fatima. She's a daughter of Aba Abdullah. She was ill. Imam could not take her with him. He looks at her, bids farewell to this young daughter, Fatima. Yes? Imagine this daughter of Imam al-Hussein. Just place in your minds, what was she going through? She looks around. She finds that her uncle Abbas, she finds that her brother Ali al-Akbar, she finds that her cousin Qasim, she finds that her brother Ali al-Asghar, she finds all of them leaving. Above all, she finds her auntie Zainab and her father Aba Abdullah bidding farewell. She's young, she doesn't understand what is necessarily going on. She wants them not to go, but they bid farewell. She is asking for their news. She sends a letter to Aba Abdullah. She sends a letter that Imam indeed receives on the day of Ashura, on the plains of Karbala. He looks at the letter. People say to him, Ya Aba Abdullah, whose letter is this? He says, this is a letter that was written on behalf of my daughter Fatima in Medina. The women say, okay, how is she? Tell us, what is she saying? It is not that she is telling about herself. She is asking about us. She is saying, what is the news of my brother, my uncle, Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas? At that moment, Hussein looks across the field. There is the body of Abu al-Fadl next to Farat, without arms, with the arrow in his eyes. Then he reads the letter. What is the news of my cousin Qasim? He looks towards the tent. There is the battered body of Al-Qasim ibn al-Hasan. Next to him is the body of Ali ibn al-Akbar. Then what breaks the heart of Hussein is what his daughter says. Tell me, what is the news and how is my brother Ali ibn al-Asghar? He looks on the side, and this is where he is buried, Ali ibn al-Asghar. Allahu Akbar. Yes, Aba Abdullah al-Hussein's love for his children. This was one way that he felt grieved. But tell me, how would he feel when he heard what happened to one of his daughters in Sham? Huh? When Imam al-Hussein would say to his sister Zainab, he would say, look after my children, look after the women folk. And Sayyida Zainab did so well. Yet when Sayyida returns to Karbala, sits next to the grave of Aba Abdullah, she says to him, oh my brother, Ya Hussein, you told me to look after your children. You gave me this amanah to protect your children. Oh brother, Ya Hussein, there is one of your children who I have left in Sham. Oh brother, Ya Hussein, one of your daughters wanted to see you so badly. Oh brother, Ya Hussein, your daughter Sakina, we left in Sham.
Ala la'natullahi ala al-qawm al-zalimin. Wa sayya'lamu al-lazina zalamu ayya munqalabin inqalibuna wal-aqibatu lil-muttaqina wa inna lillah wa inna ilayhi raji'un.
One of the important points about the Majalis of Aba Abdullah al-Hussein, according to the narrations of the Ahl al-Bayt, is the fact that the du'as are answered after these majalis. Raise our hands, let's pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for the barakah of the establishment of these glorious majalis of Aba Abdullah al-Hussein. We pray to him subhanahu wa ta'ala to forgive our sins, to allow us to die in the state of the love of Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad. We pray to him subhanahu wa ta'ala to protect the shrines of the Ahlul Bayt, including and importantly the shrine of Sayyida Zainab and Sayyida Ruqayya Sakina in Sham. We pray to him subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant victory to our brothers who are fighting ISIS or Daesh in Iraq and in Syria.
We pray to him, subhanahu wa ta'ala, to hasten the reappearance of our 12th Imam, to make us of those who continuously establish the majalis of Aba Abdullah al-Husayn, and to allow us to rise with the holy 12th Imam. I ask you to recite Surah Al-Mubarakat al-Fatiha for the thawab of all of your marhumin, for their souls, and all mu'mineen and mu'minat, before it aloud salawat.